Sci-Fi for Me is about to take you on an incredible journey into the realms of science fiction, fantasy, and horror. Interviews with writers, filmmakers, artists, and actors. Conventions and fandom. Previews and reviews of movies and television. Sci-Fi for Me is working to be the most popular science fiction magazine in the solar system. Subscribe now and enter the fantastic world of Sci-Fi for Me, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
Welcome, everybody. It is Monday. And it's time to get going. I got all my screens up. I got ready to go. And it is not a commercial Betamax player. That is, that's a Betacam SP deck that came out of a TV station long, long, many moons ago. And that's actually those little mini Star Trek figures there on the corner. That's actually Sulu and Kirk from the 2009 movie. I'm not sure where I got those. But yeah, there's a Betacam SP deck there. There's an HD. Little JVC HD deck back there in the back, and then down there below is a 3/4-inch deck. Old machines, and they all still work. From back in my television days, part of my 34 years of being a broadcast professional. Anyway, hello everybody. We are live from the bunker. My name is Jason Hunt. I am the editor here at Sci-Fi for Me. Yes, 34 years in the business. And got my start in radio, which kind of is the podcast stuff that we do now. If you listen to Sci-Fi for Me Radio, it's available on a number of different podcast platforms. So you can check us out there. But I do want to invite you to check out the live video on occasion, because we have visual aids. If you are here with us live, the chat's open on both YouTube and Odyssey. And we've got all sorts of social media accounts you can find us. We've got the Discord server that you can jump in various different conversations there. So, okay, let's get into some of this. Apparently, Sodom and Gomorrah came to the Grammys last night. Oh my. Yeah, I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but Variety has this headline. Sam Smith, Kim Petras bring Satan, cages, and whips to Grammys in fiery, unholy performance. I saw a clip of this. And I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but man, have we just gone down the degeneracy route, that rabbit hole, so much that this now is just this? How is this acceptable? How is any of this becoming something that is I don't want to say mainstream. Are people really listening to this kind of music? Are people really watching? why is this popular? I mean, okay, it's... And then, of course, as soon as this performance was over and they went to a commercial, you're watching the Grammys sponsored by Pfizer. But of course, you know, I said my bingo card is fill in the blank, and it's getting pretty full already, and it's now the beginning of February. It's going to be a big bingo card. I told you, 2023 is going to be a show. Got to be a show. I don't understand why this stuff. Well, there are scriptures about it. I did not have a Chinese spy balloon on. But you know what? At some point, I mean, you should probably expect balloons when you've got a clown show going on in Washington, D.C. right now, right? Anyway, Wikipedia snippet, new name that I have not seen in the chat before. Welcome. And I should mention a couple of different things. One, we got raided Saturday morning during Good Morning Multiverse. Some viewers from Lorena Creole's channel came over to the show on Saturday morning. So want to give a shout out to her. You can find her on YouTube. I don't know if she's on, I think she's on Rumble. I don't know if she's on Odyssey or not. And we are currently sitting now at 2251 over on YouTube, which is great. And this is one of those things where every now and again I get reminded that there's value in all of the stuff that we still have on our YouTube channel. You know, everybody talks about abandoning YouTube and going to Rumble and going to Odyssey. It's kind of difficult to do that because, you know, when people find you, brand new subscribers to the channel, we have this back catalog that goes back years. And when we have new people find us and subscribe to the channel, there's all sorts of things that they can watch. And that's good because it gives them a variety of things. They can catch up and they see what this channel is all about. We've been fairly consistent over the years. I got a comment about 13 hours ago talking about my interview with David Gerald. And talking about David Gerald and his work on the tour books, which he's probably never going to finish. And this comment came in 13 hours ago on an interview that I did 10 years ago. So it's gratifying and it's a little humbling because people are finding us. And they're going back and they're looking at the stuff that we do and they're interacting with it. And that's good. That's good for the algorithm. But it's also good that we haven't gotten rid of any of our stuff. You know, you can go back and you can see all sorts of different things that we've done over the years. And I invite you to do that. You know, check out the stuff that we've done. You know, all of the different reviews and the interviews and all the different things that we've done over the years. There's quite a lot. There's quite a lot. So those of you who are new, welcome. If you're just now just checking us out, just kind of kicking the tires and getting a feel, hopefully there's, you know, reason to stick around. We will try to satisfy. Real quick, we had a... Now, this is from the... This is not really Fahrenheit 1984 stuff, but it's kind of apocalyptic type of dystopian future thing, because we have the earthquakes taking place over the weekend, Turkey and Syria, And, you know, prayers going up for the families and the people who are affected by this, impacted by this. But over the weekend, I guess yesterday, this morning, I started seeing posts from people who were seismologists and researchers and people who were talking about this earthquake in a broader context. Now, this gets into some real Roland Emmerich stuff. Right, 2012 Independence Day disaster films. And we've got a few making predictions. They're saying, you know, this was predicted a while back. And apparently, and I haven't delved too deeply into it, but apparently, so earthquakes are caused when tectonic plates knock up against each other and shift and move and round, right? Apparently, there's some research, there's some evidence that supports the theory that a lot of these tectonic plates have kind of been locked into position because of various different pressures. And because of that, the number of earthquakes at like 7.4, 7.5 and higher have been reduced over the last 20, 30, 40 years, and we're overdue. So apparently, as these tectonic plates kind of push against each other and all this pressure starts building up, you're going to start seeing larger than 7.6, larger than 7.8, perhaps even as much as 10.0 on the Richter scale earthquakes starting as these pressures start to release. So plan accordingly. I mean, at some point, maybe the geyser at Yellowstone finally lets go and we're gonna have all sorts of issues, right? Hopefully not disaster level, you know, doomquake type of thing, but you know, it's handy to have a plan. Even if civilization doesn't collapse, even if we don't get the big one or anything like that, it's smart to have a plan just in case. I mean, it's winter time here in North America. It hasn't been a very harsh winter yet in this part of the country. You know, the Northeast has gotten some pretty significant snowfall. But people are talking about losing power. And I saw an artist, Lenore Art. I don't know where she was, but apparently she went, you know, 29, 30 hours without power. Snow on the ground. You have to make some plans. Stock some food away. Have a generator, you know, those kind of things. And these are not disaster prep, but, you know, define your disaster, right? Your disaster is at different levels depending on what your circumstances are. Your disaster could be the fact that you don't have power and the food goes bad in your refrigerator. You need to have a plan. Stock up. And then, of course, if civilization does collapse, you're already ahead of the game. I guess. Matween says they've been saying the new Madrid big one is due to happen ever since I was in grade school. Well, and I've been seeing this. There's a lot of people that have been talking about, you know, a number of these big earthquakes are overdue. We should have been getting bigger earthquakes, 7+, 8+ earthquakes over the last 10, 20, 30 years. So I don't. Again, I don't know very much about any of this stuff. I have not looked into it that much, I will admit. But it's interesting that I see a number of channels starting to chatter about this online, that maybe there's something to it. Maybe this is something to look into. I don't know. Hi, Cam. Good to see you in there. MS says, I help raise pigs and chickens, so I'm set. And yes, I need to make some more beef jerky. That box that I made, the batch that I just made 2-3 weeks ago is gone. I need to probably make a bigger box. I don't know, because our beef jerky goes quick. If I don't pack it and freeze it before Mrs. Boss has at least half of it, then it's probably not, I don't even bother. But we do need to make some more beef jerky. Do we make deer jerky? We haven't. We got a friend of ours that sent us some venison jerky, and I haven't tried it, but there's a possibility there. We may look into doing some venison jerky. We've also talked about doing some bacon jerky and taking bacon and instead of frying it up in the pan or putting it in the oven, actually doing the jerky method and see what that does with it. So we may try that. We'll see. And I'm not quite ready to get some chickens. we've been socking away we've been socking away some eggs. There is a way to preserve them. Yeah, besides putting them into brine water, pickling brine water. There's another way to preserve eggs. We've been scrambling them, putting them into ice cube trays and freezing them, and then vacuum seal them and put them in the freezer. So we've got some eggs preserved that way. We've talked about doing some brine bucket type storage, but we haven't gotten there yet. So, there's all sorts of things out there that you can do for preparing for, you know, tough circumstances, let's say. So we'll see. We're not quite off of that yet. We're getting ready to start back in with the garden. I feel pretty accomplished this weekend because yesterday I managed to get more gutter covers installed. So most of the compound now, the gutters are covered. I got some other stuff that I got some more gutter that still needs to be done, but I'm getting there. We'll see. All right. Yes, water glassing eggs. Water glassing eggs. Mazer says, another soft topic, wondering how you and Mindy are feeling about The Last of Us, the latest episode taking place in a post-apocalyptic Kansas City. I was not even aware that The Last of Us most recent episode was in a post-apocalyptic Kansas City because I'm not watching the show. I haven't played the game. I don't even know. Is it on HBO Max? I haven't even watched it. I'm not up to speed on any of that stuff. I will say, however, that if they did it the same way that Mad Money did, shooting in Shreveport, it's probably not even going to be reflective of actual Kansas City. So I don't know. It's interesting. Death Angel Shadow says, I need to build frames for my garden. We've got a section we're looking at right now that we've got to expand. But you know, we got to get the tiller into the shop because it's got a leak. It's losing gasoline, so we got to get that done. We have the compost to do. We have all of the dirt to turn and prep and get everything ready because it's getting time now to start planting stuff. So I don't know. Maybe we do a gardening channel. Gardens for Me. Do we do that? I don't know. Another video game that I'm probably not going to play, not because I don't have an objection to the game, but I don't have a device to play the game, nor do I have time to play the game. It's Hogwarts Legacy. It's coming out this week. And I tell you, there are some people that are having some ethical dilemmas. There are people having some moral dilemmas. There are people clutching at their pearls over this game. Well, Cam says they don't have morals or ethics. They probably do have some morals or ethics, just probably not good ones. I mean, Saul Alinsky had morals and ethics. They just weren't all that great. It's a belief system. Yeah, it is a moving goalpost. But the funny part of it is, see, this goes back to the whole concept of the cancel cult to begin with, is the fact that they eventually turn on each other. They eventually eat their own. And yes, J.K. Rowling is pretty far left, but she's also smart enough to recognize there are two genders. And women are getting erased, are getting marginalized by transgender activists. Not the general transgender population. There's a distinct difference. And you can say that about any group. You have the group, normal people, just want to give along, live our life, and just do our thing. And then you have the activists. Then you have the vocal, sometimes violent, activists. And that's the group online, the 12 angry, crazy people on Twitter that are calling for all of this. Boycott, boycott, boycott. If you, look, you want to boycott Hogwarts Legacy, that's fine. J.K. Rowling's not going to lose any sleep over it. One, she doesn't have anything to do with the game. As far as direct development here, she's involved in the game. They paid her. She's gonna make money, whatever. They paid her. They make the game. And you buy the game, you don't buy the game. She's already gotten paid. She gets paid a licensing fee. Game's coming out. She's gonna get paid regardless of whether you buy the game or not. But there are some people who are going to punish the game company for actions and speech from J.K. Rowling. One of those, Checkpoint Gaming. I think this is an outfit out of Australia. And Australia's got their own problems, let me tell you. But they have announced their flounce. This is what I'm calling it, folks. This is the announce the flounce. Right? We're going to announce our exit. Not that anybody cares, but we're going to make a big deal out of it. The Checkpoint Gaming team has made a conscious decision to not provide any coverage of Hogwarts Legacy due to J.K. Rowling's involvement with the Harry Potter IB and her anti-trans sentiment. She's never come out against transgender people, by the way. The game will not be reviewed by us. We have already declined a preview offer. It will not show up in our weekly coming out web feature or radio segment. It will not be discussed on our live broadcast, and it will not be involved with our Game of the Year nomination voting process. That's a heck of a run-on sentence. At least they've got commas in there. As you all hopefully know, because we're going to make sure that everybody knows, Checkpoint Gaming is an out, loud, and proud LGBTQIA+ organization. Boy, that alphabet soup just keeps getting more and more dense, doesn't it? The trans community, including those who listen to us, read our content, or contribute directly as part of our team, is incredibly important to us. The value they bring is significant and necessary. Their feeling of safety and support is paramount above all else. Look, okay, I'm not going to go any further with this. Our audience is important to us. Our readers are important to us. Period. And that's all you have to say. Why draw a distinction? Our black readers are important to us. Our blonde-haired readers are important to us. Our blue-eyed readers are important to us. Our Puerto Rican viewers are important to us. What difference does that make? Do you have money? If I'm selling a product, My biggest concern is, do you have money? Do you have the discretionary income that you can spend that money maybe on my product? Now, we don't sell a product here. We deliver news and commentary. This is talk radio, talk radio on TV, news on Saturday morning. You know, it's pretty straightforward, down the center fare. And everybody's a volunteer. I would love to pay everybody. I would love to generate enough revenue with this thing that I can hand checks to everybody that contributes to this site. That's partly why we've set up the memberships. It's partly why we have the subscribe star. It's why we have, you know, we're going to be setting up a merch store. But that's not going to be anything that's significant enough that it generates revenue that I can actually pay people, you know, a sizable income. That's the reality of things. I mean, we get up to 22,000 subscribers or 220,000 subscribers, then maybe that changes. Right now, we've got 2250. That's the way it is. We have 106 over on Rumble. We have 231 on Odyssey. We're not a big channel. But from the comments that we've received, most of the people who come and take a look at what we're doing, for the most part, they like what we're doing. And that's gratifying to me. That's good. It means we're doing something right. Not necessarily doing something on the right, but we're doing something right. The basic not being political, not being corporate, that formula works for us. MS, how to succeed in business. Write a book about how capitalism is evil, then sell tickets at $95 to speak against it. Isn't that what Bernie just did? I don't know. Did Bernie do that? Then you have here another announce the flounce, Veronica Nicotine Ripley. Cotton candy hair color, so of course it's a clear 85% of the time it's a clear indicator that you're going to run into trouble. Now I have to be careful with that because Mrs. Boss had a little streak of purple in her hair, a little streak of pink in her hair, but she didn't do the whole head. She probably would not be Mrs. Boss right now if she did the whole head. Because it's a clear warning sign. Right, Eliza?
Veronica Ripley, a statement on Hogwarts legacy. On Saturday, February 4th, I was made aware of the extensive and blatant ad campaign for Hogwarts Legacy on Twitch.
We're selling it. We want you to buy it. That means we're going to advertise for it.
Utilizing and interrupting streams to promote this offensive product.
How is it offensive, exactly? I mean, it's a Harry Potter video game. How is it offensive? That's my question. I mean, that right there. How is it offensive? You may get offended by something that J.K. Rowling says, or you might get offended by something J.K. Rowling writes on her blog, but that doesn't have anything to do with this video game. So what exactly in the video game do you find offensive? What in this product that somebody is selling do you find offensive enough that you have to announce your flounce? Well, how dare they? What? What offends you?
Hogwarts Legacy is a product ultimately funding J.K. Rowling, whose well-documented stance on trans people remains firmly rooted in a callous disregard for human life.
Wow. Okay, one, J.K. Rowling's never come out against transgender people. J.K. Rowling has basically said there are two genders. And women do not need to be erased as a consequence of the cause for transgenderism. You can't erase women at the same time. That's my understanding of what she's been saying. Is yes, there are transgender people, and transgender people have their place, but so do women. Biological women who still identify as women. You can't just get rid of them. You can't erase their spaces.
Therefore, I will not be streaming to Twitch while this ad campaign remains active. I call on every streamer to join me in taking a stance against bigotry, hatred, and those who support such views. I call on Twitch to end this harmful relationship with Hogwarts Legacy and to continue to take steps toward providing a safe space for the trans community.
How is it harmful? How is it harmful? I mean, given the nature of society right now and the decline of the culture and the fact that Twitch spends so much time propping up hot tub streamers, might you want to reevaluate your priorities just a little bit? Maybe. I would say, this is just me being the old man in the room, but the hot tub streamers don't really have all that much to recommend them in the way of wholesome family values content. Twitch was supposed to be about playing video games. Hogwarts Legacy is a video game. And if you're going to be honest and objective as a reviewer, then you're going to put it into a vacuum. J.K. Rowling doesn't have anything to do with the game. Let's evaluate the game on the merits of the game. The story, the game mechanics, the playthrough stuff, the environment, the details, the design, the graphics, all of that. That's what you review. That's what you're talking about when you do an article talking about it. And actually, that's what CNET has done. And from what I'm gathering, a lot of reviews of this game are positive, and we're going to talk about that right after this.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, your portal to the science fiction multiverse.
I find it difficult to get excited about it. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if it's my natural cynicism or my pessimism.
Tempered with a dash of pessimism.
I don't know, maybe I'm jaded at this point.
Perhaps.
The H2O Podcast, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
All right, we are back. The reviews are coming in for Hogwarts Legacy. And most of them are positive. So let's see what we can see, shall we? All right, so I've got just a few here. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on it. Clownfish TV has got a good video on it. I think Yellow Flash has got a video on it. And I think Yellow Flash got unbanned from Twitter and then rebanned from Twitter over this whole Eliza Blue thing. I don't know. All right, so here's CNET. Headline, Hogwarts Legacy rekindles that Harry Potter magic. And it's a fairly positive. It's okay. I'm not gonna go through all of this. I don't care. I say that. This is a mix for me, because I'm more interested, from a commentary side of things, I'm more interested in how people are responding to this, not necessarily what they're saying. This is a fairly positive, I mean, this is a positive review. And then you have this here. Oh, no, that's not it. Here we go from Endgadget. Why I'm reviewing Hogwarts Legacy. It's our world, not hers. See, this dives into the controversy. And this article here, to me, is very telling. When it comes to this kind of stuff. This is Jessica Condit writing this. 5 days ago, a review code for Hogwarts Legacy landed in my inbox. I've been thinking about this moment for more than a year. Probably with angst. Ever since the backlash against the game started gaining traction online. Well, whose fault is that? The author of the Harry Potter novels is transphobic, and she's targeted transgender women in particular. Let me see the receipts. Show me. Prove it. Let me see. What did she say? What exactly did she say? And what are you taking out of context that she said? Continuing here. For this reason, some people in the LGBT plus community and allies beyond, there's that word, allies, have decided to boycott Hogwarts Legacy and admonish anyone who chooses to play or stream it themselves. So the admonishment involves a lot of name calling, a lot of blocking and muting, and how dare you? On the flip side, potential players point out that the author wasn't involved in the creation of Hogwarts Legacy, and her status as the world's richest author won't change regardless of the game's success. Also, they really want to play it. Okay. I fall into the second category. I'm currently about 15 hours into Hogwarts Legacy, and I'm just barely scratching the surface. I'm having an incredible time. This feels like the RPG that Harry Potter fans have been waiting for, rich and alive and absolutely packed with magic. Here's where it gets interesting, folks. And I'm gonna blow this up full screen so you can see this. Because she said something positive about the game. And then says this. It's slightly frightening to write that down, knowing the condemnation I could receive. It's an extra light version of the dread I felt while publishing literally anything during Gamergate. But this time, it's more personal. The hate would be coming from people I actually care about. I'm worried about the cancel cult coming after me, because I'm part of the cancel cult. I'm part of the left. I'm part of the progressives. I'm an ally. I'm part of this community. But I know they're going to eat me alive if I'm honest about what I think about this game. That's what this paragraph says to me. Now we get into bona fides. I've been a video game journalist for the past 13 years. I'm a bisexual woman, and I have a big old Harry Potter tattoo next to an anti-turf tattoo. Folks, Here we go. Let me give you my virtue credentials along with my professional credentials. At least she leads with the professional credentials first. I mean, she says she's been doing this for 13 years. It doesn't say where. Doesn't say how often she's been published or if anybody's reading her stuff. She's been a game journalist for the last 13 years. Okay, fine. But more important than that is all of this other stuff. I feel uniquely positioned to care about this particular topic, and to that end, I have a quick story to tell. I'm not even going to get into it, but essentially, this person found her safe space in Harry Potter fan fiction. And as like so many other people, the fan fiction becomes the headcanon for these folks. And the fan fiction becomes more real than the actual stories written by J.K. Rowling. Because this becomes their identity. And again, this goes back to something that that was said in our Discord server. And it's spot on. Nail on the head. MS says this. These people, fill in the blank, whatever those people are. These people are creating these things. Whether it's fan fiction or Batwoman or anything in between. These people are creating these things. And when they make so much of a big heap-em deal about the sexual identity of the characters, or the gender of the characters, or the race of the characters, or anything like that, it's an extension of their own identity. I'm writing this story so I can put myself in the story. And if you're criticizing the work, by extension, you're criticizing the people creating the work. And I think this absolutely nails all of this. Because what have we said before? Twitter was okay until Tumblr banned the porn. And when Tumblr banned the porn, all of these people who had found their safe space in these shipping and fan fiction and fan erotica and all this other stuff involving all this slash fiction, all of those people went over to Twitter. And Twitter lost its mind. Now, social media, by extension, has all gone haywire crazy. But this right here, this article, speaks exactly to that phenomenon. We had all of this fan fiction, and we had all of this great stuff, and we had all of this that was ours. And it my representation. Well, okay, you can have all of that. That's fine. The existence of the real Harry Potter franchise doesn't negate all of this stuff. I mean, you do whatever you want with your fan fiction, but that's all it is. It's fan fiction. It doesn't inform the actual real franchise. And you might want it to. You might project your own expectations and headcanon onto what's really part of the franchise. But that's not going to make it legitimate. And thus, does not make you legitimate. And that's the crux of the problem. We want our identity, we want my representation to become the definitive version of this, whether J.K. Rowling wants to do anything with it or not. And that's part of the problem. Because if you don't like what the people making the product are doing, and your identity is tied up in your fandom of said thing, what are you going to do? It's not healthy. It's not healthy. And you know, Hogwarts Legacy is just the latest example of this. I mean, she mentions Gamergate, right? It goes all the way back to that. It goes farther back than that. But Gamergate will always be that specter, that boogeyman that never goes away. Because Gamergate exposed a lot of these journalists for the not objective people that they were. Whatever Anita Sarkeesian wants to say about Gamergate, Gamergate was not about sexism in gaming to start with. It was about ethics and journalists who were covering and reviewing games without disclosing that they had actual relationships with the people making the game. Whether they were financial relationships or just friends relationships or romantic relationships or sexual relationships, might want to know that going into reading your review, because you're clearly not unbiased at that point. And people didn't like that getting exposed. And then you had ComicsGate. And that's still a thing. I mean, you still have stuff going on with ComicsGate, even to the point now where you've got somebody like Eric July making $3.7 million. And Kevin Grevia comes out and says, say what you want about Eric July. He just did it. He just created a comic book and made $3.7 million on a comic book. He did it. He's not just talking the talk. He did what Stan Lee did, what Jack Kirby did. He created a phenomenon with Isom. Now we got to see if he can maintain it. What's Isom number 2 going to do? What's Isom number 3 going to do? What's that universe? What's the Ripperverse going to do? But starting fresh out of the gate, $3.7 million, not too shabby. And you have these sites, whether it's gaming journalists or comic book journalists or general science fiction horror journalists, Mary Sue, IO9, Kotaku, all of these sites are going away because that's not how you run a successful business, by sitting there and saying, we don't like this certain thing, and we don't like this certain thing, and we don't like this certain thing. And all of those things that you don't like have absolutely nothing to do with what your business model is supposed to be about. If you're going to review video games, play the video game, tell me what you think about the video game. I don't care what your opinion of J.K. Rowling is. I don't care what your opinion of J.K. Rowling's views on anything is. I don't care what your opinion of Donald Trump is. I don't care what your opinion of Joe Biden is. I don't care what your opinion of Gamergate is. If you're going to review a video game, play the video game, write a review and say what you think about the video game. How are the graphics? How's the music? How's the story? What do the cutscenes look like? Does it all play and does it all flow? Is this a giant world? Can I get to explore the world? Or am I stuck in this particular storyline and I got to play it through before I can do anything? Tell me about the game. Tell me what you think about the game. Are the characters designed well? Are the voice actors doing a good job? Are the game mechanics there? Am I going to walk into a wall? Or do I get to get on the horse and I can ride the horse? Tell me about the game. Same for comic books. If you're going to review a comic book, tell me about the comic book. I don't care about the politics of the person writing the comic book unless a person's personal ideology gets so front and center in the story that it takes over. Well, you can comment on that. And right or left, doesn't matter. Same for books. Speaking of which, I do have I do have my review of Reinception that I'm working on right now. I've got to get it out there. It's in the pipeline, I promise. And we've got so many books here to read and review. But I'm not going to write a review based on my own personal politics and what I think about whatever personal politics of the author. That's not the way you do it. It's not professional. I'm just saying. And there are consequences to making those kind of choices. There are consequences when you announce the flounce, when you make those decisions for your site. Oh, I'm not gonna do that. I'm not gonna cover that game because of J.K. Rowling. There are consequences. And we're starting to see more consequences when it comes to the comic book industry. This came to my attention also through our Discord server. Newsarama co-founder makes a surprise exit from the comics journalism outlet. This is Graham McMillan writing this on Popverse, which is, I don't know who owns this, because there's only like three or four different sites that own things anymore. It's the end of a very particular era, with Popverse learning that Michael Doran, it might be Doran, comics journalism veteran and co-founder of Newsarama, has parted ways with Games Radar Plus and Newsarama after more than a quarter of a century. Doran started writing about comics online in a series of postings on the Prodigy message boards in 1995. Well, I haven't heard that in a while. Eventually titling the post Prodigy Comic Book Newswire. As his posts started getting shared in different locations online, the posts were retitled The Comics Newswire, then The Newswire, and eventually Newsarama, a brand co-created with Popverse contributor Matt Brady. Let's see. He goes through basically his history here with Newsarama and all these things. But here's the interesting thing here. 2000, Future PLC purchased the site as part of a larger deal in 2018, with the Newsarama.com site becoming part of the general pop culture entertainment site Games Radar Plus, Games Radar, as a comic-specific vertical. So basically, at that point in 2018, which was now 5 years ago, Newsarama went away. Newsarama got folded into Games Radar as just another section of Games Radar. Kind of like IO9 got folded into what are they folded into? Crap, I can't remember now. But IO9 is now no longer just IO9. IO9's folded into being a division of something else. Newsarama is one of the few comic book journalism sites that's unionized, although management such as Duran and Bishop were excluded from the WGAE recognized union. You remember that? Gizmodo, yes, thank you. Thank you, Death Angel. While neither Duran nor Games Radar have commented on or even confirmed Duran's departure, any email sent to his Games Radar email address prompts an auto response that reads, quote, I am no longer at Newsarama. Please contact George Marston or Roland Bishop. So Duran has gotten out of the way. He's left the company. Duran's departure is one that impacts a couple of Popverse apps. Editor Chris Arant was a long-term staff member and contributor to Newsarama before launching this site last year, the Popverse. So Chris Arant was at Newsarama for a long time. And now he's not. And he actually, I think, left Newsarama about the time it got folded in to Games Radar. I'm not sure. He was an editor there for a while. And speaking of Chris Arant, he's gone over here to Twitter. You like creator-owned comics? There's creator-owned comics journalism. And he lists all these different ones. Comics Beat being the first one. Of course, that's Heidi McDonald's stomping ground, Heidi McDonald being part of the Whisper Network that was exposed a couple of years ago. But let's take a look at this. here's Chris Arant, who's got his site, The Popverse, and he's talking about all of these different other people that cover comics, movies, and TVs and whatnot. And a lot of them are looking for people to give them money, donate money through various different processes. And you can give money to them directly. He's basically encouraging people to go and support these groups financially because advertising revenue is gone. The bottom has fallen out. All of these websites, gone. They're shells of themselves. I mean, our site doesn't even get traffic as much as I would hope. A lot of it has to do with the fact that we spend so much time on video over here on the various different video platforms. But I was really surprised. I posted this really long, extensive, detailed article on the new DC Universe stuff, and it's barely gotten any traffic at all. Now, we got a huge spike on our January 1st article about what was going on over at Wizards of the Coast. Huge spike on that one. But our huge spikes don't translate into spikes on any other article, which really surprises me. So we don't have very much traffic on our .com, which is fine. I am working on a review of Reinception by Serena Strauss. That's coming to the .com. It is. Death Angel Shadow says they're all getting bought up and rolled into each other, or firing all the journos and replacing them with ChatGPT. That's coming. ChatGPT is going to be a problem. If it's not already, it kind of is already, because it's being tested. People are saying, you know, write a poem about how great X and so is. Well, I'm sorry, that would involve political bias, and I'm not a political bias type of thing. Well, write a poem about how thus and so is. Oh, this so and so is so great and wonderful. And hang on, you just said you couldn't do this, but you can, if the politics are right. ChatGPT is going to reflect the biases of the people who programmed it. It's just like any other program. Just like any other machine learning or AI or anything, it's going to reflect the biases and the preferences of the people who program it. This is not how you succeed in business, folks, by announcing your flounce, by taking sides. It's just not. We don't take sides. Now, I have my opinions, and my opinions are my own. My opinions do not reflect the opinions of everybody here. We make that clear. There's little graphics that are everywhere, all these different disclaimers and stuff. You know, and the opinions that are expressed by the guests on these programs belongs to them. Your mileage may vary. You may agree with some stuff that I say. You may disagree with stuff that I say, and that's fine. There's not a rule that says you're only supposed to agree with me if you want to be part of our audience. I'm not going to do that to you. MS says everyone on Discord got to Coach. What happened to Coach? I didn't see that. I'm going to have to take a look. You talking about over on Echo Base Network? I'm going to have to see what happened to Coach. Emma says, I pity the fool who doesn't join us on Discord. Direct quote from Mr. T. You know, I haven't heard from Mr. T in a while. I wonder how he's doing. He's got to be doing okay. Hopefully he's doing okay. But yeah, join us. You can find us over on the Discord. Let me where is it? Let me do that. Put that there. Ah, oh, come on. Put that there. and show you. I can show you here. I can show you our Discord server. And yeah, the link is in the chat, and the link is in the show notes. So you can jump in and join us in our discussions, various different topics that we cover. Some discussions are a little bit more extensive than others. We've got a pretty good thread going over in the tabletop topic as well as the comics topic. So, you know, you can join us over on Discord. And you can also join us if you're into social media. You can join us on various different social media accounts as well. And do connect with us on Odyssey and or Rumble. Odyssey, we can do the live. We're not doing Rumble live yet because we just don't have the traffic over there yet to justify the expense. But do connect with us on those, because at some point, maybe Mama Susan decides that we don't do the right thing here on YouTube. You need to find us other places, just in case the axe falls and we're not on YouTube anymore. I don't anticipate that's going to happen, but you never know. Okay, that's going to do it for us today, folks. Thanks very much for being here. Tomorrow night, we've got a new H2O podcast at 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 Central. We've got a bit that we're going to do. This assumes that something doesn't break news-wise tomorrow. I mean, we got the Disney call on Wednesday, and that's a whole nother thing. But assuming we don't have crazy breaking news tomorrow, we're going to have on the H2O podcast tomorrow night, we are going to be talking with Mr. Predicto, and we're going to be asking a bunch of questions of our crystal ball, and we're going to talk about that. So that's coming up. Then we have, of course, Live from the Bunker weekdays at 1 p.m. Eastern coming up on Wednesday. I'm not sure exactly how we're going to do it yet, but on Wednesday we are going to be doing something with the Disney call. I don't know if we're going to watch it live because Valiant Renegade is going to be doing that, and I know everybody's going to be watching that. We'll probably do a post-game show of some sort. Wednesday is going to be a weird day, so watch our socials. We'll post links and do some stuff there. Then Thursday night, the Ranker Pit, 8 p.m. Eastern, 7 Central. We're going to be talking about a lot of different things. And I imagine we'll probably talk about the Disney call as well as the most recent couple of episodes of The Bad Batch. But there's a lot of stuff happening this week. This is a crazy week. And Wednesday is going to be loaded with regard to Disney, because you get the earnings call, you've got the special session in the Florida government talking about Reedy Creek, all of this. You got the Nelson Peltz stuff. And speaking of which, I'm only going to mention this, but you should probably look at Valiant Renegade and WDW Pro on the videos that they dropped yesterday with the latest news about what Disney's plan is for Star Wars moving forward. It's pretty choice, and I imagine some people are going to have some things to say about it. We may open up. I don't know. Just be watching our socials. Get into Discord and join us there, because I imagine this is going to be a very lively, active discussion about all of the things that are coming out about Disney and Star Wars this week. And of course, Indiana Jones right around the corner. So stay with us. Stay with us. And do consider getting a membership. I don't put a whole lot of emphasis on this. We've got a couple of members. The memberships are open now on both YouTube and Odyssey. do consider being a member. You don't have to. There's nothing that says, you know, become a member or else. But there is that. That's another way that you could support us. So that's it for us today, folks. Thanks very much for being here. Remember, the media are not your friends. The government doesn't care about you. They want you to think there are five lights. But there are only four lights.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Copyright 2023 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.